light from the sanctuary. Gives us the high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary, and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord erected and not men. When Jesus did not return in 1844, as indicated by the 7 weeks and 2300 days prophecies, it was necessary to revise the prophecies, and they are found in Daniel 7 and Daniel 8. Babylon, the Persia, Greece, Rome, the judgment, and the purification of the sanctuary are the same event. The cleansing of the sanctuary was not the second coming of Jesus. If Daniel 8:14 and the judgment of Daniel 7, 9, and 10 announce the same event, what sanctuary needed to be cleansed? On the other hand, what trial could have begun in 1844? A true sanctuary, the purification, the judgment set, mercy and justice, the lawyer and intercessor. A true sanctuary, and who serves in the sanctuary, a true tabernacle set up by the Lord, not by a mere human being. If the sanctuary to be purified was not the earth, what was it? In studying the Bible, Adventists after the disappointment of 1844 discovered that there were two sanctuaries, an earthly sanctuary, a figure and a shadow of the true one, a heavenly sanctuary erected by God Himself. The first sanctuary and the temples that followed it until AD 70 were built after the model that God showed Moses. In them, the true lamp and high priest was represented. Jesus. First, Jesus offered himself for us to take away the guilt of our sin. And secondly, he intercedes for us, freeing us from the dominion of sin and securing our salvation. The purification of this sanctuary. In this way, he will make atonement for the most holy place. Because of the uncleanness and rebellion of the Israelites, whatever their sins have been. Although the Israelites were forgiven by presenting their sacrifices, their guilt was transferred to the sanctuary. Therefore, its purification was necessary. This happened on the Day of Atonement, known even today among the Hebrews as the Day of Judgment. Its one had to afflict his soul. No secular activities were carried out. The high priest entered the presence of God. The ark, the veil, and the golden altar were cleansed with the blood of a goat. Another live goat carried iniquities to an uninhabited land. They were finally cleansed from sin. If someone did not grieve that day, repenting of their sins, they were cut off. His fate was sealed that day in the same way when the purification of the heavenly sanctuary is completed. Our destiny will be sealed. Meanwhile, today is the day of afflicting our souls, the day of decision. A trial. He said in a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship Him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water." According to prophecy, the purification of the heavenly sanctuary, that is the judgment, began in 1844. Since then, the Adventist Church has loudly proclaimed that the hour of judgment has arrived, inviting everyone to worship God and to live according to His commandments. But won't judgment take place when Jesus comes to earth? When Jesus comes, He executes the judgment already carried out, since He comes with a reward to repay its one according to what He has done. He sends His angels to gather the elect and resurrects those who believe in Him. Note that dead unbelievers are not resurrected when Jesus comes and are therefore not judged in at that time. Mercy and justice. In love, a throne will be established. In faithfulness, a man will sit on it, one from the house of David, one who in judging seeks justice and speeds the cause of righteousness. The Ten Commandments placed in the ark represent the standard of judgment, divine justice. The mercy seat placed between the law and the presence of God represents divine mercy. His blood is sprinkled on the altar of burnt offering. The path to celestial sanctuary begins by accepting the sacrifice of Jesus. His blood is sprinkled on the altar of incense. Continue with a life in communion with Christ. His blood is sprinkled on the veil before the ark and concludes when our case is presented before the judge. Justice requires compliance with the law. Mercy accepts the perfect life of Jesus in place of ours. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. The lawyer and intercessor. Therefore, he is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Jesus' life revealed God's love to a needy world and a watching universe. His death revealed the hideousness of sin and provided salvation for all humanity. His intercession in the heavenly sanctuary provides the benefits of the atonement to each one who reaches out in faith to receive them. Throughout our lives, and of course at the time of judgment, Jesus is our advocate. The work of Jesus in the celestial sanctuary teaches us a clear understanding of the plan of redemption, the demands of the law of God, the infinite price of our salvation, the path that Jesus opened to reach the Father, security of being able to approach God with confidence. Soon, the judgment will end and Jesus will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him. As the books of record are opened in the judgment, the lives of all who have believed on Jesus Christ come in review before God, beginning with those who first live upon the earth. Our advocate presents the cases of its successive generation and closes with the living. Every name is mentioned, every case closely investigated. Names are accepted, names rejected. All who have truly repented of sin and by faith claim the blood of Christ as their atoning sacrifice have had pardon entered against their names in the books of heaven, as they have become partakers of the righteousness of Christ, and their characters are found to be in harmony with the law of God. Their sins will be blotted out, and they themselves will be accounted worthy of eternal life. We are now standing in the outer court, waiting and looking for that blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in his intercession as our advocate. Christ needs no man's virtue, no man's intercession. He's the only sin bearer, the only sin offering. Prayer and confession are to be offered only to him who has entered once for all into the most holy place. He will save to the uttermost all who come to him in faith. He ever liveth to make intercession for us.